This is a general introduction to, it says CMC metadata, but in the end, I think those that expect like very specific information about CMC metadata might be a bit disappointed. It's more an introduction about into metadata, and then for what you can do when you have CMC corpora, and some information about language data repositories and what the options are and what they are and why you should use them. So let's start with the metadata. As Egon, I think, already said in his talk, metadata is data about data. So the idea is that you have some data and then you describe it in a specific way and mostly as detailed as you can. And of course, it should be structured. So as Egon said also, when we looked at CMC corpora, some of these corpora that weren't deposited in a research data repository had their metadata as, for example, some prose text on a website. And while that's better than having no metadata, that's still not so nice. It's better if you have it structured and if you have it machine readable or machine actionable, that the computer can actually interpret the metadata and make it, for example, available in a search engine in an easy way. And the idea is that this helps your data to be findable, the F in FAIR, also for yourself. I mean, if you accumulate a lot of data and then, as Egon said, if you put it on the shelf or having looked at it for 5-10 years, then it's also nice to be reminded like what you did with it. So if you have detailed metadata, then you don't have to think so hard and you can more easily remember what you actually did. And of course, it's also in the idea of open research and of collaboration in research. You want others to be able to reuse it, and for them to be able to reuse it, they first have to find it and find out about it. The trick with metadata is, in my experience, to find the right balance between having not enough detail. So if you just write, okay, this is a corpus, or even just this is a CMC corpus, then someone who looks specifically for data on Twitter, they don't know, is it Twitter data or is it something else? So you need more details. If you just don't have enough information, then it's harder to judge if the data set that you're looking at is actually what you need without looking at the actual data, which can take a lot of time. First, you might need to ask for access or stuff. And then also, if you look searching for stuff in a search engine, like the VLO or the OLAC search, then it's harder to find the right data if the metadata is not detailed enough. But on the other hand, there's also the risk of having too much detail. So if you have look at metadata and you get multiple pages of metadata, then the user that looks at it might be overwhelmed and think, this is way too much detail. I was just wanted to know if it was data from Twitter or Facebook, but I didn't want to know all of these details. In the first place, maybe at some point it's nice to have this, but for the first judgment, is this data interesting to me? You would like to have not too much detail either. And also that sometimes even if you have too much detail, it can be harder to find the data. Because if you provide a very specific, I'm not sure if my example is actually real, but for example, if you want to be precise and say, okay, this data is actually in Austrian or in Swiss German, then maybe it's not so easy to find it if someone just looks for German data and wants to include all these varieties. So a metadata, like everything, has standards. Unfortunately, for CMC corpora, there is no agreed standard yet, at least as far as I know, and I hope I would know. There are common standards in linguistics, though there's the relatively basic one, Dublin Core, DC, and the extension OLAC, and there's also the SIMD standard developed within the Clarion infrastructure. But there are, of course, lots of other standards or other ways to express metadata. For example, one way that I forgot actually, and I just remembered in the talk that I saw by Harald, is that there's actually metadata in the TEI header, which I never really liked because I always think it's better to have the metadata in a separate file instead of having the data and the metadata in the same file. But maybe that's also just a question of of preference. Anyway, also when we also talk about repositories in the second part of this talk, and if you decide to deposit your data in a specific repository, then usually you get they kind of tell you which metadata they want to have and in which kind of standard they want to have it. So in that case, you don't even have to think about it a lot. You just use what they tell you to use. So quick, some words about the existing standards. There's Dublin Core, or DC. It comes from the library world. It's very, very widely used. Also widely supported by software. But on the counterpoint, because it's so widely used and because it's supporting so many different different use cases, the information that it provides is very basic. So it has information, for example, about the author of a resource or the description or information about the language something is in. But because of that, the Open Language Archives community, OLAC, has developed an extension for Dublin Core, where they added some additional linguistic fields. So additional metadata fields pertaining to linguistics. For example, they added something like linguistic field, where you can, for example, add something like lexicology or language documentation. And they added something like linguistic data type. For example, you can say this is a corpus, or this is a lexicon, or this is something else. And there are a couple of those. So you can basically keep using Dublin Core, be compatible to Dublin Core, but also have some additional information that are give more details, more linguistic details about your data. The other big thing is, of course, I'm coming from Clarence, so I have to talk about SIMD. SIMD is the component metadata infrastructure. It was developed by Clarence relatively early on. So I don't know, 8 years ago by now, I think. Or maybe even longer. And the idea of SIMD is to try to accommodate a wide variety of users. We had this discussion in the beginning. Do you want to have like one standard to rule them all and force everybody to use the same metadata fields? And then SIMD is kind of the compromise where you say everybody's using SIMD, but everybody's SIMD can be slightly different. And the idea is that you still stay compatible in some way. So the SIMD is made in some kind of modular design. You have so-called metadata components, so groups of fields. For example, you have a component, creator, and then this component information about the name of the person that created the data and the function and maybe the contact details and the institution they were working when they created the data. And then these components can then be built together. So the common analogy is Lego. So you have these little building blocks and then you build them all together, and then you have your own metadata profile with all the information in there that is important for your use case and only this information. And the interoperability will be maintained by using shared concepts. So each of these components, each of the elements, even in the components, can have a concept linked. And then even though someone says the name of a resource should be called name, and someone else says, oh, but this should be called title, they both can refer to the same concept. And then software and also users can see later on, okay, these things actually mean the same thing, even though they use different names for it. One good thing about these using these standards is they're improving the findability. Both OLAC and SIMD are part of the infrastructure, and they come with discovery services. In OLAC, that's the OLAC search. So everybody that's using OLAC can provide their metadata to the people at OLAC, and then they add this to their search. And the same is true for SIMD. If you're using SIMD, you usually are a member of Clarin, and then you provide your metadata to the Virtual Language Observatory, which is the Clarin data catalog. Yeah, and yeah, as repositories can register the metadata with one or both, but of course you have to have it in the specific form. So for OLAC in Dublin Core OLAC, and for Clarin in for the VLO, you need to have it in SIMD form. And then you need to do some specific technical things that's not so hard to do usually. And then the repositories can provide the metadata to the search engines, and then the data can be found. And if someone finds it there, then referred to the repository where the data actually is hosted. So this is how the search interface of the OLAC community looks like. So they have, for example, also these geographic field that is not so common in Clarin, where you can actually search, oh, I'm looking for data from Europe, and then you can just click here and then it's filtered for this, and you can also filter by language and yeah, by field and other kind of things. And similar, the Clarin VLO. So you can just search by through the whole metadata by just entering a search term. Or you can use the facets, for example, show me only stuff in German from for example, yeah, show me only stuff in German, but that is from Italy, or that is from, that's only spoken or not written. And yeah, you can filter down pretty nicely to what actually data you're looking for. And then here you can look at all the metadata in the VLO. And if you found what you're looking for, it links you to the repository where you can find the data and then hopefully have access to it. So some words about metadata for CMC. As I said, there's unfortunately no commonly agreed standard, but apart from, I mean, you want the general metadata, of course, you want to have information about the person who created the stuff and the language the data is in. But for CMC, some fields are, yeah, I think, and I think most of you would agree, are obvious, and most of them are pertaining to the provenance. So like, when was the data collected? As we heard that a chat corpus that you collect today and a chat corpus that was collected 15 years ago look very different, because chat has evolved a lot and is no more like something that is, yeah, happening in, for example, in Slack and using a lot of emojis. And 15 years ago, it was probably IRC or some other chat rooms. And there you probably, emojis weren't even a thing, and you were looking at emoticons or ASCII art or something like this. So that's, and then the date, when you have information about when the data was collected, then you have more of an idea what to expect. Same is true for where's the data coming from? Is it from blogs or from Facebook or Wikipedia or whatever the news hottest social network is? So that's also interesting. And then kind of related to that, what format is the data in? For example, Twitter, I think, doesn't even allow you to copy tweets anymore. I actually have lost track of this, but at least I've seen corpora that didn't contain actually the full tweets, but only contained links to the tweets. And that, of course, is very valuable information about the corpus that you want to know, ideally before you invest a lot of time at working with this. And then, yeah, also as a format, is it Wikipedia articles, is it blog articles, whatever you have. And another important thing is how the data was processed. So was it pseudonymized, was it anonymized, was it already part of speech tagged, or was it cleaned up in some way? So were there things removed, or were there things adjusted to make it, yeah, for example, how Pavel said in the morning, like, did you do some processing also to make the data shareable? So all this information is important to know, ideally before you invest time in starting to work with the data. And of course, the most important thing, what are the licensing conditions? So if you look at a CMC corpus, you want to know, when I download this, can I actually do anything with it apart from looking at it? For example, can I use it for my own research, and can I maybe even reshare it? All these kind of things are interesting. This is actually the everything I have to say about metadata for CMC corpora. But I think, especially in light of what Harald said, that there should be also information about metadata for CMC in the submission to the TEI Council. I think that's something that we as a community, CMC community, should really start discussing and maybe agreeing on at least some standards or a set of standards, or I don't know. It's something that needs to be discussed, and I think it's becoming more urgent because it's once you have a corpus and you didn't use a certain metadata standard, it's a lot of work to convert your existing metadata to a new standard. Also, especially if the new standard contains information that you didn't originally record any metadata, and then maybe you didn't even collect this information when you created the data, or you don't remember it, or it's hard for you to figure out exactly, for example, when the data was collected, when you don't write this down when you do it, and you get it from a source that doesn't have the data attached, like for example Twitter, I think, has timestamps. To figure out this kind of information. So I think it would be a good idea to start working on some kind of standard. And can you still hear me? I'm sorry.
Yes, but your connection froze a bit.
Yeah, I got a message that I was my connection is unstable. I'm sorry. So, but you can hear me again, so I'll just continue. Anyway, my point is, there's no standard for CMC metadata at the moment, but it would be really good if we started developing one. And that's the first part. Now on to the second part, language data repositories, or more the correct term, I think, is actually research data repositories. And they, by now, they are really common. So in most academic institutions, you will find some kind of research data repositories. Here in the Netherlands, most of universities have them now, and they're usually attached to the university library in some way. And then in that case, it will be a general purpose repository, so one for the whole university. And then, it will have to be this kind of one size fits all approach. So that means you probably won't be able to record a lot of very specific metadata. It will probably just be Dublin Core. So you have who created the data, when was it created, which language is it in, and who can use it in, and how. But there's also domain-specific repositories, for example, ones that specifically pertain to linguistic data, or of course, environmental science or other domains also have their own specific repositories. And the idea is basically once you start looking into this, you have to figure out if you're happy enough with using a general purpose repository, which might be easy to access, or if you rather want your data in a domain specific one, which means that A, you can have more fine-grained metadata, and also your community will more easily be able to find your data, because a domain-specific repository will probably be indexed by the domain-specific search engines, and a general purpose repository might not be. So the fairness of repositories, as we heard in the beginning and this morning, repositories help with the two first parts of FAIR, so with the findability and the accessibility. And basically you get a lot of the features of findability and accessibility for free, at least if you put in the effort to store your data at the repository. So they store the data safely, there will be backups and people will take care of the data and will check if it's still there and if it hasn't been corrupted in some way. And the data is also stored securely, so no one can easily just get it without going through the process of authenticating and getting authorization. Then the repositories will automatically assign a PID to your data, which we heard is an important part of fairness. So that means that even if at some point the system changes, the PIDs will stay, and you will always be able to re-find the data using this PID. The repository will also force you to add some essential metadata to your deposit. So for example, I think almost all repositories will force you to choose a license for the data, so you can't have this licenseless data that we heard about in the morning anymore. And they will also, they will provide you with some guidelines on which metadata you should add and in which way. Then usually repositories also provide easy access for you and for others to the data, for example, through using a single sign-on. So which means that usually they use this kind of single sign-on where you can use your university account from your home institution to sign in to a repository somewhere else without having to create a separate account. And then this this process already tells them that who you are, and it tells them that you are working at a university. So that means if some material is restricted to academic users, then they know you are an academic user and they can give you access to this kind of material. And they can also identify you to, if you need access to something that has needs specific, that you need to specifically ask for access for, then they can know who you are, and then they can say, okay, to this corpus we give you access, and if you do something bad with it, then you know who you are and they can track you down if that's necessary. As I said, usually repositories also propagate the information about the data to domain-specific search engines. So that means that it makes it even more easy to find your data, because the repository will make sure that the information is spread out throughout the internet. And then someone is looking for the data, they will easily find it at the repository. There are a couple of different types of repositories. So these are three of the most common softwares that are used for data repositories. There's Fedora Commons, DSpace, which I think actually now belong to the same company, and Dataverse, which I think is coming up. I keep hearing this more and more. But this is something you don't really need to concern yourself with. It's just something I wanted to put out here. And then there are instances. So there's these general purpose repositories, for example, at your local university. There's also the ones Egon mentioned, there's Enodo and Figshare. And then you have the infrastructures, for example, MetaShare. And I will focus on Clarin. So Clarin centers are a specific type of repository. So Clarin is basically a network of centers. So there are all these nodes where people are working for Clarin, and a lot of these nodes what we call in Clarin a center. So and the center often usually also has apart from the knowledge center like the CKCMZ, the other types of center also have a repository where data is hosted for the Clarin community and usually also for the research community as a whole. Each Clarin member country hosts at least one center where you can deposit your data. There is kind of the national Clarin repository. So in case you can't find anywhere else you could go with your data, if you're in a Clarin country, you can always go there and say, okay, we're in Clarin, so please take my data and take care of it for me. You can find an overview of all the Clarin centers in the Clarin Center Registry. And there's also a more a list with more details on this webpage where the depositing services of Clarin are listed, and it tells a bit more of what kind of data they usually are hosting. So if you're looking for something specific in your case, if you're looking for something specific for CMC data, I think Egon said that already in the morning, the Clarin Center at URAC is specialized on non-standard communication, and CMC is part of this kind of non-standard communication. So if you have CMC data, then talk to them and they will probably be happy to host it for you. So just a quick overview of the repository landscape in Clarin. This is something that is, I think, a bit outdated. I think it's from last year. But as you can see within Clarin, there's a lot of different types of repositories. So you have some of these DSpace and Fedora repositories, which are very common. And I think DSpace is still gaining ground because it's easy to install package, basically, that if you start a new center, you can just take this and get running in relatively short time. But still, there are a lot of people that use different things, even Git or Dataverse, I think, is up and coming. So I think there are now more already. But as you can see, it's a very different landscape, and there's a lot of different types of repositories. But they all share the same kind of services. So they all provide you with a PID for your corpus. They all provide metadata. So they tell you which metadata you need to fill in, usually in a web form. And then they provide this metadata as CMDI and Dublin Core. And this, using this, they provide it to the VLO and to the OLAC search. They will also help you with depositing. I mean, you can, a lot of repositories, you can just go there and ask them, and then they give you access and you can just start depositing your data yourself. But they will also help you with, for example, with choosing a license or with some metadata fields. It might not be completely clear what should be going in there. And then, as I said, all the Clarin centers also are part of this authentication and authorization infrastructure. So they provide you the opportunity to just log in there using your normal credentials. And if for some reason that doesn't work, we know that some universities are not completely compliant to the standard for one reason or another, or sometimes even have good reasons. And in that case, you can always come to Clarin and ask for a Clarin account and use that to get access to all the repositories and also the tools and software that is available within Clarin. Then you should look at, so when you start looking into depositing your data, that's something maybe you should think of relatively early, so that you know, for example, which metadata you will need to provide. Usually a good idea is first to just look at your institute. Maybe they run a repository, and maybe they have some dedicated policy to say all our data is actually deposited at repository X. If the institute doesn't have one, maybe your institution, university, has a general purpose repository. And as I said, it's a bit of personal taste. It might be easy to deposit your stuff there. You have short ways, you can go there. Once there's no pandemic anymore, you can go there in person and talk to them and get hands-on help with depositing the data. But on the other hand, it's a general purpose repository, so you might not be able to provide extensive detailed metadata. For example, information about the stuff that I said, basically, all the details, CMC metadata, you will not be able to provide probably in a general purpose repository, at least not in a machine readable way. Maybe it will just be, you can probably attach a text file with this information, but this might not make it more easily findable. And the other way is to just look for a domain-specific repository outside your institution. If you're a member of a Clarin country, which I think maybe all of you are, most of you probably are, then you can either talk to your national Clarin coordinator. And so or the Clarin member or the Clarin member states have a national consortium, and there is usually someone involved in user involvement, and then they can help you with finding the right repository for you, or you can go directly to the list that I showed in the couple of slides ago, to the list of Clarin depository services, or in your case, if you're a CMC corpus, you probably want to talk to either the CKCMC or go directly to URAC. I think if you write to CKCMC at the moment, you will reach URAC anyway. So these are obvious places to also go to if you look for someone that is experienced with CMC corpora and also is experienced in hosting them. And I think that's all I had. I said it's just a very generic introduction on this topic